is CNN 10, and I'm Carl Azus at the CNN Center. We're happy to see you this Tuesday. The Organization for the Prohibition of Chemical Weapons, or OPCW, is an independent organization. Its goals include getting rid of the chemical weapons that some countries have made and helping protect people from them. And on the same day that the U.S., the U.K., and France launched airstrikes against the Syrian government for its alleged use of chemical weapons in the town of Douma, investigators from the OPCW arrived in the Syrian capital, and they've been waiting to get access to Douma. The attack on April 7th killed 75 people. The World Health Organization says 500 others were treated with symptoms that a chemical weapons attack would cause. The United Nations bans the use of chemical weapons in war, but the OPCW says it's seen more than 390 accusations of chemical weapons use in Syria since 2014. Western leaders blame the Syrian government for using them in Douma. Syria and its ally Russia have strongly denied it. And the OPCW team is trying to find out what the truth is. The U.S. is concerned that Russia might have tampered with evidence at the site of the alleged attack. And the U.K. has accused Russia and Syria of keeping OPCW inspectors from entering Douma. While they wait and hope to get access to the site, CNN's Arwa Damon recently spoke to survivors of the alleged attack. Their story shows how even those who live carry the scars of war in their memory.
And there's definitely something that stings.
These backpacks belong to Malaz and Mesa, 7-year-old twins from Douma. They're a little shy, hesitant. We smelled something, Malaz says. Their mother, Umnur, tells us they remember everything vividly. They were hiding in a basement when the alleged chemical weapons attack in Douma took place. They could barely breathe. She felt her body go limp. She clawed her way up, dragging her daughters. But then the other strikes began. We were between two deaths, she remembers, either from the chemical strikes or the others on the rooftop.
The smell is still quite strong. These are the things that they weren't able to watch yet. And look, that's the toy that her daughter hid away to try to keep her safe. And she would tell the toy, you know, you might suffocate, but at least you'll be safe from the bombing. That's how the kids' minds work. Yesterday they were digging a tunnel for the ants so that the ants wouldn't suffer, just in case something happened.
In another tent, we meet a boy with a jagged scar running across his abdomen from shrapnel. His uncle, who doesn't want to be identified, was among the worst affected in the family in the chemical strike. He says his blood sample was taken the day before. This new camp is inhabited with those who survived the siege of Douma. It's relentless, months-long bombing that drove families underground so that something as simple as feeling the sun on their skin was a luxury.
10-second trivia. We are such stuff as dreams are made on, and our little life is rounded with a sleep. Is from what Shakespeare play? The Tempest, Hamlet, Romeo and Juliet, or As You Like It? These are the words of Prospero in Shakespeare's play, The Tempest. Will we one day wake to a world where we can re-watch our dreams on a video recorder? Or is that just a pipe dream? There are a number of scientists working on technology that could answer those questions. At the University of Texas at Austin, researchers are using a device to measure nerve impulses while people sleep. Electrodes on their arms, legs, chin, and lips are trying to detect how people are moving and what they're saying in their dreams. A separate study at Japan's Kyoto University is using a type of MRI to look at brain activity as people wake up and then try to reconstruct the images they saw in dreams. And another group at Northwestern University is using electrodes on brain surgery patients to detect the activity of specific brain cells. A researcher there says this could determine the subject of dreams, like a mom or dad. Put all this information together, one scientist says, and you might be able to see a type of replay of your dreams. A machine to do this does not exist. Researchers say that could be decades away, and if something like it is invented, there are some ethical concerns about it. Could dreams be hacked somehow to get private information about someone? Researchers say most people have 4 to 6 dreams per night, but forget 90% of them. Scientists do not agree about the function dreams have or how important they are. The dreams of an American student and football player named Corey Bethley go beyond the touchdowns he scores. He's working to fulfill the dreams his mother had for him and to keep the promise he made her. Corey's an example of a positive athlete, a young person who's making a difference or persevering on and off the field. CNN.com/positive athlete is where you can go to nominate someone for our news series.
I'm Corey Bethley. I go to Dom Lugo High School. I'm going to the University of Hawaii to play football, and I have this tattoo. It represents my mom and when she passed away, and who's who I play for.
It was probably the worst news that hurt in my life. It was a thing you don't prepare for or a thing you don't know what to tell your kids.
I lost my mom to brain cancer at the age of 6. She'd come home and then start feeling sick. Until she'd go back to the hospital, and then eventually she just ended up losing all her memory and everything, and she just passed away.
1, 2, 3, family!
That's who I play for, her and my family, and just want to make it just so I can take care of my family and just live out what she wanted us to do, just get our education.
General ed first, and then you can get the bachelor's degree is after that.
Well, right now we're currently about 36% of our students qualify to go to colleges, including Corey. He's been a great role model in letting students know that despite your circumstances, you need to keep going forward and finish with college so that you can make a good life for yourself.
I made a pledge to my mom before she passed away that I would get my degree in college and graduate and get my diploma.
He's a very humble young man.
We want to take a moment to introduce all of our seniors. Please welcome number 6, Corey Bethley.
She's always watched like my angel. She's watching down on me.
In the Northern Hemisphere, it's officially been spring since March 20th, but the first part of April has brought blizzard conditions to the Northern Plains and the Upper Midwest. The cold and the snow have set records in several states, including Michigan, where meteorologist Gary Frank of affiliate WXMI reached a limit.
I think it's going to be fine.
Good.
You know, it'll be fine.
All right.
Could be worse.
Yeah.
Has been worse. Well, because you guys are dragging me down. You guys keep... Well, every time I get done with the 7-day, you guys are like, oh, gosh, 4:30, 5:30, 6:30, and then you expect me to be chipper for 5 straight hours. It's miserable.
Well, what are you supposed to do?
I want you guys to say, wow, that's great news. It's going to be 60 on Friday. Well, I mean, what do you want me to do? Lie to you? I'll put 70 every day next time. God. Here's some wind, here's some temperature, 20s. Feels like 19 or feels like 70, I don't know. Here's a 60, I don't know if that's good enough for you guys. Get excited, maybe I'll disappoint you with the 7-day here in a few minutes.
Ooh. Is he done?
Is it safe?
That was terrifying.
Well, the weather outside is frightful, and I guess he didn't want to weather any more criticism. That kind of thing could give anyone an icy demeanor. Thankfully, he got the meteorologist of his report across, and even with his burning frustration, the weather itself still managed to ensure it was a cold ending. I'm Carl Azus, and that's CNN.